we're in the third of three lectures on Talmudic history, and I've hoped that these would be somewhat cumulative. They are standalone, so you can appreciate them on your own, but on their own, but I really was hoping that the three of them would fit together. In the first lecture, we talked a little bit about the tremendous changes that were wrought upon the Jewish world with the advent of printing. And I'll do a very quick recap of that in the second slide. The second class, we talked about how the changes that were wrought as a result of printing are dwarfed by the changes promised by the internet and the incredible democratization of learning that is a result of the spread of internet-based sources promises to be equally transformational, in fact, much more transformational, because the threshold of difficulty of accessing knowledge has dropped so precipitously that literally you can hold in your hand the wisdom of the ancients to a degree with which we have never in our history been able to enjoy. So we're talking about periods of phenomenal change that we haven't really thought about because it's happening all around us and we only see it in incremental steps. Today, I would like to bring us to a little bit of a word of caution because, you know, I'm just starting to think about, well, what are the dangers intellectually and socially when we have such an explosion of information? We know if we compare this, let's say, to the church, and we look at what printing did to the Catholic Church, of course, it broke it up with the Protestant Reformation, more access to information through vernacular translations of the Bible and so on, really splintered the church into little bits. You had the one Catholic Church, and then you had dozens of Protestant churches. You know, God forbid something like that should happen to the Jewish world. We have had something of some fissures that occurred in the 19th century, not nearly as permanent as the Catholic Protestants, but these dangers are truly present. But more specific and more germane to the Jewish concern, I think, is a very basic issue of authenticity and authority in Jewish tradition. As you can see on the screen here, that's really the lecture title. It's not as exciting as the one I put in the flyers because I was hoping to get you out here, kind of a bait and switch thing. But in reality, what I want to say is that with the cheapening of information, meaning it's so easy to get it, now we begin to worry about when is the information authentic, is it real, and when is it authoritative? When should we rely upon it? These are very, very difficult questions to answer, and I'm hoping in the course of the next 45 minutes or so, I can introduce you to two cautionary tales from the modern era that I think are harbingers of the kind of problems that we would likely face in coming generations. And perhaps, you know, we can start thinking about solutions and way to avoid some of these dangerous incidents. Let me begin, first of all, by thanking our sponsor. We do have a sponsor tonight, which is nice. Where is my, here I got to turn this on, right? Ms. Elise Schwartz, thank you very much for sponsoring the lecture. It's nice that the synagogue gets the support and, you know, they give us this wonderful space to learn in and they set up the food and things like that. So it's wonderful to have that kind of support and we're all grateful. Let's go straight to the material then. Let me just do a very quick recap looking at the risky business of recording Talmud. Before I just touch on this risky business, I want to tell you that when I was preparing the lecture, I was reminded of something I saw when I was studying in the Soviet Union, or actually it was the former Soviet Union in 1991. It had just collapsed, and it was just in the initial months of its, you know, resurrection as independent states. I was in Ukraine, in Kiev at the time, and I saw a movie poster advertisement, and in Ukrainian, the word was Не безпечне бізнес. And I was trying to figure out, what does that mean? So business is, of course, business. Не безпечне is the word for risky, but literally translated, it means not without risk business. Не безпечне, not without risk. Just the term, not without risk business. That's what we're going to be talking about today. It's very exciting to see what we're doing with the explosion of democratization of knowledge, but it is not without risk. Ne bez pečne. Okay, so let us do the quick recap to remember how we got here. First of all, there are four basic stages of transmission in Talmudic knowledge. And that's also, of course, referring to really all Jewish wisdom because it follows on it. First, we have the period of oral transmission, which is in the distant past, certainly before the Hellenistic era, which would go about, you know, three centuries before the Common Era. You know, Moses stands up there and tells Joshua, I like this picture, and Joshua tells the prophets tells the elders, basically the first mishnah of the first chapter of Pirkei Avot is this oral tradition. And there's a lot of debate as to how long that continues in an exclusive realm. I actually had an interesting discussion with one of my students in Toronto who alerted me some really interesting research that said that the next stage, which is the manuscript stage, didn't necessarily start with the mishnah itself. There's a lot of interesting research to indicate that my thinking may be quite wrong. My thinking was always that the Mishnah was actually put down on paper, and then everyone busily copied it, and then people had manuscript copies of the Mishnah. It may not have circulated nearly as widely, and in fact, a lot of memorization was still utilized. Maybe there are limited copies of Mishnayos put in very special preserved places, and as Saul Lieberman, a historian of this period, puts it, that was called publishing. But at any rate, there's a big transition that goes from oral exclusivity to a written form. And that represented a very traumatic event in Jewish history as well. Here's an example of the incredibly difficult process of writing a Sefer Torah, which of course, you know, involves a tremendous investment of energy and resources and time and expertise. So not everyone can write a Sefer Torah themselves. You have to have the resources to hire someone else to do it and so on. Then we get to the print transmission, which is what we talked about at great length 2 weeks ago, which cheapened the price of these manuscripts tremendously and allowed ultimately for the institutional development of places like yeshivot, seminaries, eventually day schools and so on. Popular programs like Daf Yomi would be impossible without the widely available texts that are printed in a cheap enough version that people can put it in their hand. And then finally, where we are right now, of course, is digital transmission, where as long as you have a device and bandwidth, you can access all of this immediately anywhere you are. I mean, it's mind-boggling to think about what it means. The section that I've, you know, repeatedly sold you on over the last little while is the Alduf app, which both Rabbi Trump and I are working on. Here's the two ads that just recently came out. Mine on the left refers to my small part of this new Alduf app, which will focus on brief Jewish history videos that go on every single daf of Shas, of the entire Babylonian Talmud, and Rabbi Trump on the right, slightly smaller, but I think that's just because he's taller in real life. They wanted to kind of, you know, equalize those things. But he is going to be doing an amazing thing with the psukim on the daf, because in every page of Talmud, almost every page, there's a reference to some biblical passage. He will be providing the much greater insight as to what's the context of that biblical passage. For those of you who are not necessarily familiar with Talmudic study, this is especially important because the Talmud has this sometimes irritating habit of assuming that you have memorized the entire Bible. And it will just say the first two or three words of a verse, assuming, of course, you know the rest of it, and it's the last part that's really important for the argument in the Talmud. So if you haven't memorized that particular verse, you'll be completely lost. What are we talking about? The only way you can understand it is if you go back to the Bible, you look up the passage, you understand it in context, and you can come back and you see what they're talking about. So Rabbi Trump will be doing that work, and that's going to be a huge, I think, contribution to the study of Talmud worldwide. And these things, of course, are all completely free, which means we've dropped the price of access to zero. The only thing you have to have is bandwidth, and there is still a digital divide in many countries, and a device. You have to possess at least some kind of Wi-Fi-enabled device. But that's really a low threshold to cross, and it's going to be cheaper and cheaper as we move on through time. So that's the five stages that we're talking about, and it's related to the problems inherent in producing such a widely available series of documents. And it's related to what we discussed in the first two classes, the famous teachings of Marshall McLuhan, one of the first media scholars of the modern age, who repeatedly hammered home this same idea that the medium is the message, that the way in which we receive information itself colors the information and how we process it. If someone were, for example, to write out all of Hamlet on, paper napkins, and I would receive Hamlet in a big stack of serviettes like this, and then read it through, my experience of Shakespeare would be radically different than reading in a book or certainly seeing it performed live. There's a whole different experience in the medium through which that is delivered. Reading it on napkins, I have to figure out the words and I have to stop and I have to process it in a different way and make sure I understand it. Even reading it a book, I have to imagine in my head all of the characters, but seeing it live, then I'm already exposed to the artistry of the individual actors, the directors, the set design, all of these things. That's just one kind of simple example, but it relates very much to what we're talking about today. Because with the democratization of learning, all of a sudden, the medium changes who is learning it and how they're learning it, including, for example, exposing 52% of the population. All of a sudden, as we discussed last week, women could be learning Talmud in much greater numbers than we have ever seen before. And this promises, if the trend continues, this promises to really upend a lot of traditional Jewish society, and who knows what that is going to mean. Certainly it will mean different things in different places and different communities, but there's no question that the kinds of things we talk about today and the assumptions we make today, we will not be able to make for our great-grandchildren's generation and so on. That's one of the big changes we talked about last week. But let us focus on the concept that Clay Shirky, who is a media guru at NYU, he coined this phrase, more is different, which is really, really important. The internet is the biggest more there is, but it's not more of the same. Following this idea of the media as the message, it is more in a very different way. To give you two examples from Clay Shirky's work, he wrote some excellent books, one called Cognitive Surplus, which I recommend to my honors students usually every year. He actually, like many of you in this room I see, are more or less my own generation. If you calculated how many hours you spent watching Gilligan's Island, just Gilligan's Island alone, okay? Forget about, the Partridge Family and all the other shows from the 60s and the 70s and the 80s. Just those hours alone would probably fill up a good master's dissertation or a doctoral dissertation. And he says that the amount of availability of cognitive space, meaning the amount of time we have now at our fingertips, because of the speed of transmission of data with the internet, we theoretically could do phenomenal things. Like, for example, Wikipedia. Wikipedia is a phenomenal thing. Yes, it has problems with it and so on, but nevertheless, it is a pretty useful go-to resource, and it is there because it is tapping into the cognitive surplus that is available to us with this new medium. And with that as a kind of a caution, we're going to look now at the two stories that are relevant for today that illustrate the dangers of this, huge expansion of information in authenticity and authority. Okay, rather long preface, I apologize, but this is the third and final lecture, so I think we can get away with it. Let's go to the story of the pseudo-Yerushalmi for the first story. So I'm sure you're familiar that there are two Talmuds. That is basically two large commentaries on the Ur text called the Mishnah. One of them was composed in the land of Israel It is somewhat erroneously called the Jerusalem Talmud or the Yerushalmi. It was not composed in Jerusalem. It was largely written at a time when the Jews were not allowed to live in Jerusalem because of the Hadrianic persecutions. It was composed most likely in Tiberias, and Caesarea, in Caesarea. But nevertheless, we call it the Jerusalem Talmud. The other name that's very popular for it is the Palestinian Talmud. That brings up other problems. When you say it's the Palestinian Talmud, people get more confused. So let's just stick with the term Jerusalem Talmud, even though it is inaccurate. This one was composed... Yes, but wait, I'm going to tell you something about this. It is not actually a Talmud Yerushalmi, as we shall see. It was composed probably sometime in the 3rd century. Then there's a larger Talmud that was composed in the Mesopotamian region between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers, coming down into the Persian Gulf. That would be known as Babylonia, and hence you have the Babylonian Talmud. It was written later, probably 4th or 5th century, and it considers much of what was discussed in the Jerusalem Talmud, so therefore it is considered more authoritative because it, as it were, includes the Jerusalem Talmud. There are some significant differences in terms of dialect between the two of them. The Jerusalem Talmud has an Aramaic that is much more widely used in Israel. The Babylonian, of course, the one that's used in Mesopotamia. The Babylonian Talmud is much more concerned with life in the diaspora, and does not treat things like the agricultural laws that are very relevant if you're living in Israel, and there are several other differences. The Jerusalem Talmud was largely ignored once the Babylonian Talmud appeared. It was hardly studied. Very few commentaries are written on it, really until about the 12th century. No one is, composing commentaries on it. It's sort of like, shunted to the side because the Babylonian Talmud had the pride of place. But there's a lot of really valuable things in the Jerusalem Talmud that are not in the Babylonian Talmud, so it is always preserved. However, with the vicissitudes of time, several Talmudic tractates of the Jerusalem Talmud were lost. We know they existed because, for example, Maimonides refers to them in the 12th century, but they're gone by the time we get to the 19th century. No one knows where those tractates were. In the year 1900, in a Hungarian village, a Sephardi Tahor, someone who claimed pure Sephardic descent, showed up, very luxurious, flowing Oriental dress with robes and a turban and so on, and a very crisp, foreign-sounding Sephardic accent, revealed to the stunned Ashkenazim that his brother, who was living, I think, in Izmir, Turkey at the time, I can't remember exactly, had discovered some of the lost tractates of the Jerusalem Talmud, and he was raising funds to bring them to print. Tremendous excitement. Everyone was thrilled with the idea. And in fact, in 1907, after significant effort, he did bring them to print. Here is one of the two volumes that was published. As you can see from the top here, it says, Talmud Yerushalmi Seder Kodshim Chelek Sheni Maseches Chulin Bechoros. And it had commentaries on it that were composed for this edition, and it was greeted with incredible enthusiasm by the wider Jewish public. Many learned rabbinic figures, many scholars signed on to this and said it was fantastic, positively reviewed it. Everyone was really excited about this new development. But there were some lingering critics who said, wait a second, doesn't quite seem right. It doesn't read exactly like a Jerusalem Talmud. There's this problem, there's that problem. And a lot of criticism was brought to bear on this individual for a couple of reasons. One reason was, for example, he failed the Jewish geography test. Many Jews were saying, okay, who is this guy? He went by the name Al-Ghazi. Who is this guy? He says he comes from Izmir, so people would like send letters to Izmir and say, do you know this guy? And they'd say, never heard of him, you know? And the people couldn't locate him in the towns that he came from. And that was kind of unsettling. You know how it is. You say, oh, you're from Silver Spring. I know so-and-so in Silver Spring. You know, to me it happens, oh, you're from Canada. I know so-and-so in Canada. Thank you. It's a big country, right? 35 million people. So he failed the Jewish geography test. And he also failed to produce the manuscript. The really serious critics were saying, you know, let's see the document. We see the printed version that you produced. Where's the original? And he kept on stalling them and saying that his brother who holds the manuscripts is not revealing them and all kinds of things. Criticism raged on for a while until finally one scholar whose name escapes me, I think it was Abraham Rosenbaum, came to his defense, published some very strongly worded articles defending the manuscripts, indicating that they were real, that he had seen them himself, that this is a phenomenal find. We should immediately study. We should all buy these books, and we should house our libraries with them, and so on. Until finally, for reasons that I'll show you in a minute, Al-Ghazi was exposed as a fraud, that he was not the discoverer of this manuscript. He was, in fact, the author of the manuscript, that he had amazingly composed tractates of the Jerusalem Talmud completely out of his own mind, which we have to pause for a second and just think about the genius of this individual, okay? Like, if only he had bent his skills to the good, he could have, like, I don't know, cured cancer, gone to the moon 100 years early, but he took all of his genius and funneled it into this elaborate, complicated forgery, apparently for money. Many of the other manuscripts that he had published were then brought into question as well, thinking that they were forgeries and so on. What about the guy Rosenbaum? It turns out Rosenbaum was also Al-Ghazi, who was impersonating a student named Rosenbaum, writing in defense of himself. It was like a multiple, complicated, convoluted sociopath who inflicted this damage on the Jewish world. It turned out that his real name was Friedlander, and as best as anyone could tell, he was a fish merchant from Belarus. You know, and talk about bizarre, strange, twisted genius. And he held it over the Jewish world for about 20 years. He was successful with this forgery. But there's more. It's fascinating that he knew his audience very well. He published this Yerushalmi in two different editions simultaneously. Here's the other volume that came out in 1907, Zvachim, and he understood that there were two principal audiences for these lost tractates. One audience were the traditional yeshiva-educated enthusiasts of Talmud in Volozhin and in Lithuania and places like that. And for those people, he wrote a very learned rabbinic introduction. He had rabbinic commentaries and things like that, all in Hebrew and so on. But he also realized that the other audience that would love this are scholars in the university world. Last week, I alluded to the rather large divide that separates what's called the traditional yeshiva world and the academic world of Talmud study. They use very different methods to approach the Talmudic text and to try and determine what is the meaning of the text, why we're looking at the text, and so on. But he realized that was a very important and lucrative market. So for that audience, the Wissenschaft des Judentums, he published an introduction in German, and with very scholarly notes and footnotes and scholarly apparatus and things like that. The same volume, the same text, but two different editions designed for two different audiences. And bottom line is, both groups were largely fooled, including Solomon Schechter, who was the principal backer of the entire publication effort. And let us recall, Solomon Schechter was perhaps the greatest Jewish scholar of his age in the academic world. He's the person who pioneered the study of the Geniza documents from Egypt. He published a tremendous amount of research that he was known in Oxford, known, of course, later in New York with the Jewish Theological Seminary, a tremendous scholar, completely duped by Friedlander Al-Ghazi. And put up a lot of money to make it possible. But let us not, here we are in an Orthodox synagogue, let us not, engage in schadenfreude, that it also affected the rabbinic world as well. The saintly Chofetz Chaim himself, although he did not write an approbation, he didn't write a haskama, he just mentioned in passing, in a footnote, that it appears that these lost manuscripts have now been discovered. Nevertheless, he was also drawn into it to that extent. I think it is unlikely that the Chafetz Chaim would have been fooled by the forgery had he had the opportunity to read them. But he never had any statements on it. We have no published statements on it. But nevertheless, it gives you a sense of how broad this forgery affected the Jewish world. How was the forgery discovered? I mentioned to you he failed the Jewish geography test. He failed to produce the manuscripts, but there were internal inconsistencies. And here's where we get to the work of the incredible Rogachover Gaon, also of this generation, died in 1936. Fascinating individual who, for reasons which are still somewhat mysterious, he refused to get a haircut. No, seriously, I mean, that sounds funny, but he really did. There's a legend that says that he refused to get a haircut because he did not want to spend any time bareheaded, like in the barber's chair, that would presumably, you know, prevent him from thinking about Torah. I don't know how convincing that legend is, but at any rate, he definitely had a kind of a Nazirite look. And the Rogachover was known for his extremely sharp intellect. Just to give you one story that illustrates his sharp intellect, he was also known that he did not suffer fools. He was not at all tolerant of irritating people. You know, like you have that amazing expression in Yiddish, Chachmir Kein Chaynik, which means bang not on my tea kettle. You know, I'm sure everybody's nodding in here, so you know, but just for the internet audience living in Idaho or in Latvia, you have to imagine that a traditional chaynik, is a big tin teapot. Right? It's made out of tin. And if you imagine someone holding a hollow teapot made out of tin and banging on it with a wooden spoon, it's like a really irritating noise. So in Yiddish, chachmer kein chaynik means like, don't irritate me with your, you know, repetitive noises, that kind of thing. So there was once a story about someone who kept sending to the Rogachover these questions, but he could tell that he was only sending them because he wanted to demonstrate how brilliant the questions themselves were, and they were not. So finally, after repeated missives, the Rogachover wrote him back a multi-page letter, which consisted solely of Maramakomot, of reference points elsewhere in the Jewish corpus, specifically in Talmud. This page in Talmud over here, that page in Talmud over there. The story goes that the guy received this letter. He was so proud of himself, he walked around the shtetl, waving it to everyone, saying, look, I asked the Rogachover such a hard question. Look how many pages it took for him to answer my question. You know, it was like he was very proud of himself. Then he finally sat down in the shul to start deciphering the answer by looking up all these reference points. And every single reference point was to a page that contained the word ignoramus, Am Haaretz, right? So this is like the personality of the Rogachover gone. Anyway, how did the Rogachover expose Al-Ghazi Friedlander as a fraud? He said an amazing thing. He said that in every tractate of the Yerushalmi Talmud, there is always the name of one author that does not appear anywhere else in the Talmud. There's always a unique, what do they call it, a hypax logomenon or something like that? It's not the right word. There's like one rabbi who's in this tractate who is never mentioned elsewhere in Shas. And in the text of the pseudo-Yerushalmi, as it is now called, there were, in fact, no such figures whatsoever. Every single rabbi mentioned in the false texts were duplicated elsewhere in Shas. So it's an amazing statement, but when we think about what that means, the Rogachover must have had an eidetic memory. He must have had an immediate recall memory of the entire Talmud to be able to make such an assertion and to be able to test such an assertion. And again, this is before you had encyclopedias of Talmudic figures. I think the first one was written years later. This is before you had any kind of computerized access to do word analysis. He just knew it from reading it once. This can't be real, and so on. And that speaks to the idea of authenticity. The Rogachover, with his superior intellect, could determine authenticity. But the average person, even people with great minds and scholarship, like Solomon Schechter, and presumably, perhaps even the Chafetz Chaim, might not have been able to. Again, I have to put an asterisk on the name Chafetz Chaim, but there are many other rabbis who were signed on to the project and real true believers. So that's one story that's a caution of authenticity. I want to return to it after we talk about the second story, which is even more chilling than this rather bizarre episode of the pseudo-Yerushalmi. By the way, when I did the research on this, there are lots and lots of libraries in Europe that have copies of this Talmud, and they appear to think that it really is the Talmud. They have cataloged it like it's just another volume of the Talmud. Like, what's the difference, right? Okay. In the 17th century, there was an especially threatening moment for the Jews of Europe. There was a man named Johannes Eisenmenger, who in the 1670s, living in Amsterdam, had drawn close to the local Jewish community, and he chose to throw in his lot with the Jewish people as a Ger Tzedek, as a convert. He converted, married, had children, and studied the Talmud diligently for 19 years. An incredibly dedicated individual, absorbed into the community. Among his teachers were the chief rabbi of Amsterdam. Definitely, you know, someone that the community felt very good about. And then in the year 1700, he came out with a massive anti-Semitic screed, 2,000 pages in length, called Judaism Unmasked, Judentums Entdecktes, excuse me. And this is basically a complete survey of the entire Talmud, right? This is a person who learned the entire Talmud. If he was on the Daf Yomi schedule, he would have done it multiple times. And every time there was anything negative in the Talmud that could be interpreted badly as, or interpreted in a negative way towards the Jews, the Jewish people, Judaism, he diligently wrote it down, translated it into German, and wrote a commentary on it, a highly tangential commentary. But basically, think about this madman for a minute. He spent 19 years living undercover as an Orthodox Jew with a family, you know, raising children within Judaism, all for the purpose of producing this scurrilous document. And it was a bombshell. When he submitted it to be published, the Jews found out about it and managed to block its publication temporarily. And they hoped to negotiate with him to bribe him, essentially, to not publish this terrible document. It appeared that he may have been willing to do so. He may have engaged in a lot of personal effort to produce the book, and he could not sustain the costs of publication. That's relevant to us in thinking about what the internet means. And he was open to taking compensation and withholding publication, but they were about 6,000, I can't remember what the unit of currency was at the time, they were about 6,000 of those currencies units apart when he suddenly died of a stroke at the age of 54. I know, it's sad. But that, at any rate, the book nevertheless was published across the border in a different kingdom where it was not subject to the same restrictions. There were some shenanigans about how it was published, the title page and so on. And unfortunately, the book did see the light of day. Let's have a quick quiz. By the way, this is a great montage by my editor at JTA, Laura Adkins, who took this story and was able to put it together. You see the silhouette that represents Eisenmenger himself. On the right is the title page of the first volume of two volumes, and in the background, of course, the yeshiva boys. But here's an image of Eisenmenger himself, also with a title page underneath it. And here's a look at this book. You know, it was actually published in one thick volume and also in two volumes separately. It's a massive brick of a work. And here's the scary thing about it. All of the citations in this book are accurate. As a scholar in Israel who has gone through them one by one, compared them with the original, and every single citation is accurate, is taken from the Talmud, the Midrash, and so on. Now, the translations are often, you know, skewed in the worst possible way. The commentary is definitely slanted in a very negative way. But he did not falsify his sources. His sources were authentic. He took them out of context. He tried to twist their meaning so as to reflect badly on the Jews. And he definitely had a very tendentious purpose with the entire enterprise. But unlike the first story we discussed, which was inauthentic, this is totally authentic. It does. You can use it to look up passages in the Talmud that refer negatively, let's say, to the founder of Christianity. There are only about, let's say, a dozen of such passages in the Talmud, and there's a lot of literary theory that we can bring to bear to say, you know, why would the Jews say something negative about the founder of Christianity? It's a lot of reasons why. I mean, they're being persecuted and so on, and it's an inside document. They don't necessarily think they're going to have outside listeners involved in the document, and it's certainly, when you look at the huge size of the Talmud, and you have 2,000 different people speaking in the Talmud, over 2,000 Amoraim, if you have 6 or 8 Amoraim in that mix who say something negative, that's certainly within the statistical range of things you won't like in the Talmud. There are other things in there too, but it need not distract us. What is significant, of course, is that when it was published in German, it was almost immediately translated into English and is now widely available on Amazon. You can still read Eisenmenger today. There are many different editions. It's published under a different title sometimes, but it's essentially, it has become the Bible of the anti-Semitic world. If you go on hate websites today, which I do not recommend, you'll definitely need to take a shower afterwards because it's so gross to go to those places. But all of the charges against Judaism, especially anything related to the Talmud, they owe their origins to Eisenmenger's painstaking research. And it had tremendously deleterious impact on the Jewish people as a whole. So here, once again, we have two very different stories, two very different outcomes, but a great cautionary message for all of us. On the one hand, you have this prophet-seeking Jew named Al-Ghazi Friedlander, who attempts to defraud the Jewish world with an obvious forgery. His goal is simply to make money with it, but ultimately he used a falsified document. And if you were to study that Talmud, you would think you're studying the Word of God, but in fact you're studying the Word of Friedlander, the Belarusian fish merchant. And on the other hand, we have Eisenmenger, who, another truly sociopathic and twisted individual who devoted 19 years of his life to doing this research. You know, he published something which is so totally antithetical to the entire thrust of Judaism, and nevertheless, when viewed like through the telescope for the tiny little detail, each one of those citations is in fact correct. Taken way out of context and so on, but nevertheless correct. So, what are the implications for us and the internet era? I would like to tender for our consideration that we need to think carefully as consumers of media on the internet, and specifically as consumers of Jewish media on the internet, to attend to these two issues of authenticity and authority. It is so tempting, you know, I'm not a rabbi, but my daughter will frequently call me and ask me shilas. I don't know why she asks me. I say to her, don't you have a rabbi living near you in Fairlawn, right? Aren't there rabbis in Fairlawn, New Jersey? There must be, right? And she does have a rabbi and things like that. I think maybe it goes back to her childhood when my kids wanted to do something and they weren't sure it would be allowed. They asked me first, right? Because if I said no, chances are, mother, it was not even worth asking Ima. But if I said yes, then there was a chance they could ask Ima and they could do it, right? I wasn't actually the decider. I was like the trial balloon. So maybe my daughter is calling me because then she's going to call the rabbi afterwards to confirm. But she'll ask me some shaila and I'll be at work and things like that. And I'll say, just hang on a second. Let me check this for him. And I'll put her on hold and I'll look up on the web, right? I'll put in her question exactly like she could. And the websites will pop up. And if there's a website that I trust, like OU.org or something, or Star K or whatever, then I'll say, well, in my great wisdom and based on my years of research, I would say the halakha is mutar, asr, not today, wait till Tuesday, whatever it is. And I'm relying on the authenticity of the source. But we can easily get lazy with that. You know, who knows, will our children be able to distinguish OU.org from OU.com? You know, what if someone falsifies a website? We don't have really good, you know, barometers for authenticity on the web yet. Will our children have that? Because it's flat. Everything on the web is the same size. So will they get that authenticity? And furthermore, authority, right? If you have something that comes in a really well-dressed package, like the pseudo-Yerushalmi, and the guy's wearing the right bekesha, and he has that accent, and oh my gosh, that turban is so glorious, it's got to be real. And all the other rabbis are signing on with it. How do we know that that's real authority? These are serious questions which we have not yet put to the web, and we have not yet figured out how to put a haskam on it so that people can trust the tremendous diversity of opinion that are out there. I would like to suggest that, ironically, we've got to go back to the old-time days of relying on a rav, right? Here's my rav. Isn't that nice? I took this picture at Chakras the other day when he was delivering his morning shiur. You know, why do I need a rav? He's younger than I am. I don't know if you noticed, but he's younger than I am. You know, he's a really smart, smart guy, but I'm not so stupid either. I've studied a lot of Gemara and stuff like that. But, you know, when I have a question, I'm no geah b'davar. I know how I'd like to answer myself. I need someone who I trust who will make an independent decision. And so far, he has been great. Whenever my wife and I have issues, whenever my kids have issues, he's been able to sort of see through the whole thing and give us an answer that we feel has the ring of authenticity. Furthermore, you know, I think that the kind of elements that we get with a rav today are when a rav knows who you are, not just knows the sforum, but knows who you are, knows what kind of answer you can handle, and is able to make a judgment call based on the relationship that you have on a human level, that's something you will not find on the internet. You can't go to the internet and say, well, this is who I am. Tell me what I need to know. It won't happen. Although I will tell you a funny thing. I was in a very long meeting at my work the other day on career services. Sorry for this interlude, but I thought it was funny. My wife laughed. We're looking at, you know, how to try and improve career options for our students, that when they come to Touro College, we're thinking about different models for them to try and figure out, you know, what they want to do in life. And one of the tools that they put on the screen was this battery of questions produced by the Department of Labor, I think, the U.S. government. And I said, you know, okay, this is kind of a boring meeting. I'm going to fill it out myself. And while I had my computer there, I answered all the questions. And then I asked it, okay, so what career should I consider? So it gave me a range of 5 different levels of preparation, meaning if I really wanted to put in the maximum amount of training, go to school for as long as possible and stuff like that, what should my career be? Guess what it told me my career should be if I went to school and got a PhD? Teacher, right. It said I should be a professor. I was like, great, that's really good. Then I chose, what if I'm not prepared to do any of those things? What would be the best career for me? I clicked on that button and it said, fashion model. I know. But, okay, so I probably would. I'm George Clooney, right. That's it. So true. See, why can't I do both? I think that would be great. Anyways, I lost my train of thought. What was I talking about? Oh, yes. The rabbi knows me. The rabbi knows who I am. He knows my problems. He knows my challenges. He knows what kind of answer I can tolerate. And I think, ironically, in this age of connectivity to the web, we have to double down on our connectivity to a rav. It is so crucial for us to have a human being who has this larger perspective, who knows the difference between information, of which we are drowning in, and wisdom, which is as rare as ever. So I'd like to suggest that that is where we are going with the internet. These are the dangers that we face and why it's so important, more important than ever, for us to have a Rav. Let me conclude by just thinking about the Talmud as a resurrective document for the Jews, because we must barrel on into this bold new future. Whether we like it or not, the internet is not going to stop for us. We have to figure out how to use this tool somehow. And I want to draw your attention to a 20th century Talmud that I find deeply moving. This is the so-called Survivor's Talmud, which is very unusual because it was published in the displaced persons camp in 1946-1947. Jews living in these displaced person camps were desperate for Talmud. They were, you know, torn away from their families, torn away from their communities, uncertain as to where they would be in a few months. Would they get to emigrate to Israel? Would they get to move to America or Australia? Living under desperate circumstances and very much wishing to connect to their God and connect to their tradition. And they begged the American government, the American authorities running these DP camps, give us some Talmuds. There were none to be had, no sets of Talmuds available. The Nazis were engaging in heavy book burnings. They collected a few for their Museum of Jewish Civilization in Czechoslovakia, but they didn't have these things. What they did have, however, were the old stereotype plates used. We talked about them with Dvorah Ram. They had old stereotype plates of Talmuds, and they had the printing presses that were used in Heidelberg to publish Nazi propaganda. So the Americans said, fine, we're going to take those stereotype plates, and on the very same presses that once published Nazi propaganda, we will now publish Talmud. And they published this beautiful full-size edition of the Talmud. I want to alert you to this amazing cover here. So you can see that inside the front text, it says, published by the Organization of Rabbis in the American Zone in Germany, right? Of course, Europe was divided at this point, with the assistance of the Army of the Americans in Germany. And it says here, Munich, Heidelberg, and it gives the year here, 1947. So that's when it was published. Look at this amazing evocative artwork. At the bottom, it says here, Pasuk, Kimat kiluni ba'aretz va'ani lo azavti pikudecha. It's as if I was almost destroyed, but I never abandoned your commandments. And the caption underneath says, Machana avoda ba'ashkenaz b'yimei ha-Nazim, a labor camp in Germany in the days of the Nazis. And the artwork shows something like, it looks sort of like an Auschwitz kind of scene with Jews apparently picking up what appear to be corpses and loading them onto a wagon. Some of the most horrible sights of the typhus epidemics that raged through Warsaw and places like that. And on the sides, this barbed wire kind of theme. Everything at the bottom of the page is so dark and a direct reference to what these Talmud students had endured just a few months before this was produced. But then as you move up the page, you can see that there's these winding streams that lead the eye upward, and you see suddenly the palm trees, you see the balsam, you see this architecture that is very reminiscent of the Middle East, and then finally at the top of the page, you see this glorious sunrise over domed synagogues, Moorish-style Israeli synagogues, and it says in the text here, Mishibud l'geula me'afela l'or gadol. From servitude to redemption, from darkness to great light. And I think this is really the message of the Talmud for our purpose and in our days. It is a fundamentally redemptive and regenerative document. It is a text that Jews study to refresh themselves, to revive themselves, and if you will forgive the pun, to rejuvenate themselves. This is a document that we will constantly return to, as we have for millennia. And even though the internet poses many great challenges for the potential for Talmud study and the risks associated with Talmud study in this unusual environment, I am fully confident that we'll find our way to muddle through those challenges and ultimately we'll come to a redemption of great light. I want to thank you for your attention and endurance for these three lectures, and I hope you have a wonderful Thanksgiving. Okay. Okay.